Pot of Thunder, the recognized symbol of excellence in rock and roll podcasting. Brought to you by Blue Microphones. They look great. They sound even better. And you know me.
Don't text to Andy. It distracts him while he produces the show. Doing so will only make the quality go down.
Wow.
Tackling Dio.
Listen to that.
Man.
Excellent work, Nick.
Thank you.
It's your buddy Andy, America's little brother. Where did that suggestion come from? We'll find out in a moment.
That explains why he didn't get me involved. He realized it's beyond my capabilities, both musically and lyrically. So, I fully acknowledge that. I'm good with it.
Well, look at this guy. You ready? He's going to do it for you. Yes.
Convincing his way across the podcast studio.
Woo! Nick Pollock has entered the program. I ran over my headphone cable.
What the fuck is he doing?
He's a dancing machine. Look at him go. You could have injured a hip doing that, Nick.
I likely did, and I'll find out in a couple days.
Yeah. Was that Michael Jackson?
No, I don't know what.
Beat it dance?
So with these dance moves, mm-hmm. It's kind of like my approach to music. I can't learn what other people do, really, so I make up my own.
That's okay.
I don't know what they are.
Works for you, Nick. Welcome to the show. We're happy to have you, as always.
Thank you.
And to your left... You want him. We got him.
Oh, yeah. Succumb to my power, my age, and my weight. Well, all of which are considerable.
Yeah. Put your hands together for the breakout star of the podcast, Medium.
That may have been the best performance of that.
I think so. Ever. Yeah. I had the time.
There was something
down.
Perfect.
I didn't go Jimmy Fallon and break up in the middle of it.
You didn't giggle.
Yeah. Which is not easy to do. It's just the whole thing is so patently ridiculous.
Oh, Harvey Korman action over here.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. So here we are on the final week of 2024, February. How did it happen so quickly? I felt like we were just talking about that it was coming and now it's going.
Well, it is the shortest month of the year, so...
Unfair, isn't it?
Even though it's a day longer this year, but still short.
Can't believe it's already leap year. I don't know. Doesn't feel like it was 4 years ago. Yeah, that was like right before a pandemic.
Yeah.
That's true.
That was like the week or
that's
whatever,
what
2 weeks
when we
before.
Have an extra day to goof around in this country.
Yeah, exactly. We're going to get ourselves into mischief again. The last one was the day we did 3 episodes with Chris Jericho.
That was at Leap Day?
That was Leap Day, yes.
I forgot about that.
Maybe we started, I would say we started at the very tail end of Leap Day, and it ended March 1st, several hours into the day, 5 a.m. or something, whenever we left. But yeah, that was the Aerosmith Classic Albums Clash.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
And then I don't remember what the next one was.
Where Eagles Dare.
I remember
was
that.
One of them.
Yeah.
I think that wasn't that the one where Jericho just passed out.
That, yeah, that was the third episode. Yeah, so there was one in between that I'm failing to remember what it was.
I can't remember it either.
Yeah. But Jay was there. Our brother Jay was
he
there.
He was.
So I'm trying to think. Was it something to do with him? Maybe not. I don't know which song it was.
No
I can't
idea.
Remember. But yeah. 4 years ago already. Doesn't seem like it.
Everything is 30 years ago now. It is. Oh, I remember that. 30 years ago.
Woodstock 94.
30
They're
years.
Trying to tell us something. That was 30 years ago.
It doesn't seem like the nonsense associated with the pandemic was 4 years ago already. It seems like it was fucking last year almost.
But it did go on for like 2 years.
Yeah, but...
But yeah, you're right.
It's amazing that it's that far in the rearview mirror already.
Yeah, agreed.
But we're here for a good time.
Are we?
Tonight.
Okay.
At least tonight. I don't know.
I thought
something smells good in here, that much I can tell
Nick
you.
Nick put on cologne.
Emanating from that bag
it's
over
possible.
There?
I don't know.
What's in the bag, Nick? We'll find out. Well, I hope you baked it. Either way.
I did. Who wants to eat dainties? Who wants to eat baked treats with me? Oh, 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 oh.
So,
smells kind of savory, if I may.
Somewhat, yeah. Throw that out. I don't know. I'm surprised that
it's like somebody will come in here with some fucking barbecue tonight.
You have keen olfactory senses.
Well, you know, I call them like I smell them. and I'm thinking, I was like, these motherfuckers roll in here with some bombers tonight? I don't know if I have that kind of appetite.
It's not anything like that. But before I distribute. And before we get to the song, there's a tie-in. The song, before we get in, obviously, into the announcement of it, there's a tie-in to something. Knowing what it was, I immediately thought of something from a different type of media. And I sent it to Andy.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not going to give away the song.
Mm-hmm.
So, and the baked treat is actually tied in to that, which in my head ties into the song.
Okay.
If that makes any sense.
Sure.
So if you want to, I guess if you want to...
I'm going to share this piece of media.
You could credit the... I think it's someone we might have mentioned, a social media personality we may have talked about in the past.
Lord?
Yeah.
No.
Lord NB?
No, not exactly. For lack of
a better term. So we don't want this show to end tonight necessarily, but... LNB, if you will.
That's better.
It's let's see, what is it? Super 70s Sports posted it a while back, and it's stuck with me all this time. I just sent it to you guys. So
I could pull it up.
You could bring it up if you want to for the people on Patreon right there.
Yeah.
There's some commentary on the Super 70s Sports that I think is pretty good.
You might have to read it, you guys.
After a night of robust lovemaking beneath the bearskin blanket, it was time for a breakfast feast of giant croissants, corn, and gingerbread men.
Those are some big gingerbread men, too. Yeah, there's a man, and it's basically exactly what Nick said, but there's a man and a woman under this, appears to be a polar bear rug. That's for me?
Jeez.
Is that for me or for the keyboard player?
The whole thing is... For each
it's
of
for
us?
Me.
Wow.
Yeah.
What is this big bastard?
Oh, shit. It's a ginger, huge gingerbread, man.
I tried to make it look as much like what's in the picture as possible.
Look at this.
It smells fucking
It's actually
fantastic.
I was like, I'm not going to do gingerbread. Plus, that looks like a pastry.
It does. It looks like it's
just like crazy bread style.
So this is, I was just looking up stuff on Pinterest and came across Portuguese sweet bread.
Wow. That's probably what it is in the picture,
too. So that's what, I wouldn't doubt it.
What are these eyes, raisins?
They're little currants, little mini raisin kind of things. Yeah.
I'm going to use that for my image going forward.
Yeah, so, and I thought if we can have that image up during the song, I think it fits nicely with what the song is.
This image of the guy in bed.
Yeah, which is why we have these absurdly big
Portuguese
sweet bread. Kind of like a Hawaiian bread, if I'm not mistaken.
It does have that taste to it.
I'm looking at this spread on this table in front of these two people after their lovemaking session. There's one of those... like a cheese wheel and wax and red wax.
There's borscht with like
with a bow tie around it for some reason.
It does. Yeah. I never noticed that. The corn is like in a bowl of olives. Bowl of black olives, and then I don't know if that's like some kind of artichoke thing going on in the very front.
It looks like cauliflower and maybe green beans or something.
I don't know, but what an incredible picture.
Yeah.
Well, as we've talked about, that's got to be a post love making spread, because you ain't making love after partaking in that, as we've talked about.
I don't think anybody goes for borscht right before they're in the mood there.
Are those oysters at the top? Is that what that? Or like it's mussels either, or something?
Yeah, you know what? It might be. I was thinking either that or another kind of pastry, like a croissant kind of roll.
Oh, maybe. I can't tell.
Thing. It's hard to tell, but. And I can't help but I can't help but think that this could also be a photo from Jim Henson's honeymoon.
It does look like Jim Henson.
It sure does. Right? Yeah. And plus you got all that fur. Jim Henson always surrounded by fur.
That's true. Everywhere. So.
Yeah. In and out of the boudoir.
Jerry Kern just asked if that's a Dutch baby. Is that what this is called?
No, a Dutch baby is like I don't think so, because a Dutch baby is like it's like a bowl shape. Mm. It's like a pancake kind of thing that you bake in a pie.
Maybe he's saying that about something else, not this
maybe.
Little character.
I don't see one there, but...
Yeah, and there's a beautiful white cat blending in.
Yeah, yeah. A Siamese.
Yeah, delightful. Well, this is somehow going to... This is associated with the song in your mind.
This in my mind... When it was decided that this mm-hmm. was going to be the song, and I thought about the song, mm-hmm. this image came up. So I said, okay, it's not a video watch along, but we have this image.
Yeah.
And perhaps people who are not on Patreon right now listening, people who are listening on Monday morning.
We'll post it.
Yeah, right? We'll post it. They'll be able to have the image accompanying it.
Yeah. I'm just curious. I mean, there's a lot of unanswered questions here, but what's the context for why this photo exists?
No clue.
The man is shirtless.
I think that's part of the beauty. Yeah, the man's shirtless.
Does she have some kind of straps?
It's hard
to
tell.
Or is that part of the fur?
Some stray fur, perhaps.
Yeah, she might be topless as well underneath there.
Well, why wouldn't she be?
Yeah, I just thought, at first I thought she wasn't, but now I'm thinking, yeah, she is.
There's a bottle of something back there. There's what looks to be like almost a...
That was a fondue pot.
A fondue pot, yeah. Yeah.
This is very of the time.
Yeah, this is a...
Hairy man. Yeah.
And the song is from the 70s. So.
Okay.
The tail end of the 70s.
All right. Well, we'll put it back up again when we get into the song in a minute.
Sure.
But so this is going, as the tradition goes, the final week of February is a Lou Rawls song because the month celebrates Lou Rawls in the style of Lou Rawls. So this month we're not going to stray from the plan, right?
Okay. And not only that, but I made an eBay purchase recently. For just this
for today
occasion. Yeah,
you spent money for this.
I did.
What the hell?
A collectible American Bandstand Lou Rawls
autographed
card.
Holy shit.
Autographed by the guy who sold it to you.
Well, it looked legit, so I went for it. Plus I was able to lowball the guy a little bit.
You didn't offer.
I went.
Is that what you were asking me about?
I went $10 under. He went for it.
Okay. He's probably had it.
Next thing I know, it's on the way.
He's probably had it sitting there for years. On eBay, I mean, just constantly
most likely.
Relisting.
There was one time I was going to order something very similar to this.
Yeah.
And I had it a modest price, and it was actually, you know, an auction where the time was running out.
Mm-hmm.
And it was maybe in the 20s mm-hmm. dollar range. And the last minute, for some reason, it went up to 60. I was classed out of it at that point, but for whatever reason, somebody went in there and decided they wanted it for an absurd amount.
A couple people were fighting over
it.
Someone probably did the like the reserve, or not the reserve, but the you can set your amount to whatever, like I'm taking this, I know it's at 20
within
but
the last minute,
but I'm putting it at 100 or whatever, 60, and then someone else came in and did the same thing, and someone won.
It was a dogfight in the last minute. Like I had it for a couple days. I had the leading bid, and then all of a sudden,
the worst.
Something crazy went on.
Except it's the best when it happens when you're selling something.
But this
like,
one,
these fools
out.
Buying this bullshit I'm selling.
Two people going at it, the dick swigging contest, and you're going to be the beneficiary. But was this recently or like early eBay days?
Oh, you said this was
early. This was just like a couple years ago.
A couple years
ago. I had the idea of getting something like this, and. Yeah. So we'll have Lou right over here.
Yeah. Good. All right. So is there anything you want to say about the song before
I do.
You go?
It was the song was chosen in part because of some lobbying by a couple of listeners.
Oh, no.
Which would be Mr. Chris Camarado and his wife Ellen.
Oh, okay. Well, that works.
That works.
I was afraid it was going to be the Caruso.
For a couple of years now, Chris has it has sent me messages that this should be the song this year. Okay, this should be the song this year. And now, this year,
this
it
year
is
this year. We were about to say,
"Get the fuck out of here, Lonnie. Take that dumb shit with you."
But instead, we say,
"Not bad, Nick. Not bad, Nick."
Well, we'll see what you think.
Yeah. Well, these are wonderful people. And I believe today, the day of the recording, is Ellen's 49th birthday.
Wow.
If not today, it was yesterday. So happy birthday
to her. Happy birthday.
Wonderful people that my wife and I met when we were in Philly a couple summers ago.
Mm-hmm. So you can confirm that we're not being catfished by someone who is pretending to have a wife.
I can't confirm. Well, I mean, I think their relationship is a tad more complicated than that at the moment, but no, they're real people and legit, not weirdos. That's which you never know what you're going to run into. And they probably had this, the same reservations meeting me, listening to my drivel all these years. It's like,
true.
What's this guy going to be like in real life?
Yeah,
yeah.
But
maybe
it was a great time. Yeah,
maybe we're the weirdos.
Well,
you ever
maybe.
Think of that?
I never did, but oh no.
It's true.
Devastating
Absolutely.
News. This is bad news.
Would you ever, before we get further into it, as I'm almost about to attack the head of this gingerbread, or what was it?
Portuguese sweetbread?
Portuguese sweetbread, man. Mm.
Would you, next time, if you ever make this again, would it be off base to request a little sea salt sprinkled over the top?
Certainly not, yeah.
Just a little twinge of saltiness to counteract the sweetness would be absolute perfection.
Okay. Yeah.
As it is, it's very good, but I find myself craving a, like, almost a pretzel-like topping. Not a lot, just a little.
Okay.
Dash of salt on the top would be perfect.
That little salt works with pretty much everything.
So you wouldn't be opposed to that?
No, definitely
I'm not,
not.
Being an asshole.
No,
here,
certainly not.
Requesting it. Okay, good.
Very good. Yeah, so I guess I'm ready to announce it.
All right.
I've gotten enough nonsense out of the way here.
None. Let's turn the microphone over to Chris Jericho.
All right, Harold. This one's called
Lover's Holiday.
Off of
Let Me Be Good to You.
By the band
Lou Rawls.
Ow! Oh!
Jericho's excited.
He's excited.
He's always excited about this month.
He loves it. I think he listens.
Everybody should.
Everybody listens.
Come on now.
Hi, if you're listening. Hi.
If you're not, this is better.
This is better. Whatever you're listening to, no, this is better.
So Lover's Holiday.
Yeah, so another year without my favorite, but that's okay. That just gives me a reason to look forward to next year.
You know what? I'm not mad.
And
this one right here, I actually talked it over with Chris. I was telling him that the side B, the 1-2-3 punch, all three were, I'll use the phrase dogfight for the second time in this episode. In my mind, it was a three-way dogfight.
Wow.
which actually works with the first song, Bark, Bite, Fight All Night.
Oh,
then,
I like that.
Then the title track, Let Me Be Good to You, and then Lover's Holiday. And in honor of Chris and Ellen, I decided we'll go with Lover's Holiday. It's something that they've been asking for a while.
What is the title of this album again?
Let Me Be Good to You.
Let Me Be Good to You. Okay, I'll find it.
What's the year?
1979.
79, okay.
Yep, came out in May of 79.
Yeah, there it is. Track 7 of 8.
It's in that filler position.
Yeah.
Well,
next to last song.
There is no filler in the Rawls catalog, but along the lines of what Andy was talking about earlier, or a minute ago, to his point, kind of similar, but I was thinking about this. There is one considerable downside to February for me.
Hmm.
You want to know what it is?
What's that?
I want each year the week four song to be a new discovery for me. Mm-hmm. So that keeps me from delving into the Lou Rawls catalog on my own. Because let's face it, if you got Spotify like I do, the entire world of music is at your disposal at any point. You know, you don't have to go out and buy the physical copy, blah, blah, blah. It's whatever you want to listen to is at your beck and call whenever you want it. So, I mean, I could just, anybody could go on a deep, full-on dive into the Lou Rawls catalog and just listen to the whole damn thing if you wanted to.
Yeah.
I consciously avoid doing that because I want week four of February to be a new discovery for me. So that's a bit of a downside.
Yeah, but double-edged sword there.
I can rise above it, and, you know, I think it's worth it to have these new discoveries come my way each year. So there you go.
And this song, I believe, features the backing vocals, I'm pretty sure, of the Jones Girls.
Ooh.
Detroit American R&B vocal trio.
Never heard of them. Sort of like the Andrews Sisters of Motown.
Except for...
Or maybe this is later than... But,
well, yeah. It's... Yeah, so we've got...
That looks like Afa and Sika from here. I don't have my glasses on. Well, you might... Are you showing me the wrong picture?
Where's the Jones?
Oh, no, not at all.
There's the They're Jones lovely girls. Ladies.
I seriously didn't know what you were showing me from across the room.
I wonder if they were easy to work with or if there was plenty of Jones Girls bullshit going on in the...
Jones Sisters.
Their Jones Sisters bullshit.
That's probably the one and only time Lou Rawls worked with them.
No, he worked with them, I believe, quite a bit back around this time.
He just put up with it.
Like me. Me and Lou Rawls have something in common.
The juice was worth a squeeze.
Yeah.
In my case, it's not, but I still put up with it. So.
Yeah.
Yep. So, Lover's Holiday.
That's the title. Lover's Holiday. Yeah, look at this. Oh, I like track two. What's the matter with the world? It's nice.
Yeah. It's, let's see, I believe, yeah, one of the co-writers, of this song was one of the co-producers of the album, someone named Dexter Wansel.
Okay.
Who produced the Jacksons, Teddy Pendergrass, Patti LaBelle.
Teddy Pendergrass is probably somebody I gotta consider for next year.
Yeah,
that guy's right in the wheelhouse.
Yeah,
there's
not been represented yet, but that guy's underrated in terms of this kind of music and the theme of the month.
Yeah,
that one of my favorite thing about Teddy Pendergrass is I'd read somewhere that there was a Valentine's Day concert that it was put on a pretty big venue. I think it might have been New York City somewhere. Ladies only. And they handed out chocolate teddy bears.
Oh, man.
Like on a stick, like a teddy bear pop.
So no men were allowed in the venue?
That's, I guess it was women only at this show.
It's pretty
well, that's
awesome.
What, Shep Gordon? Is that his last name? Alex Cooper's guy?
Yeah.
That was, he managed him as well. So.
He did, huh?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Got around. Wow, okay.
Anyway. So...
All right, well, I've got it up here. I've got lyrics if we need them. It looks like there's a lot of lyrics in this song. Maybe not.
It's not,
A lot of short phrases, and then the enter key pressed to start a new line. Looks long, but all right. You want to get into it? You ready?
Yeah.
All right, let's take a quick commercial break. We'll be right back with Lover's Holiday.
Hey, my lady.
Gotta stop it already. Let's see, this sounds like it could be last week's song with that drum intro.
It's got that vintage vibe, although this wasn't vintage, obviously, when it came out.
Yeah.
I thought about that, too, but I went for it anyway, that it's kind of similar to the vibe of the
That's what the
song
month is supposed
week.
To be, so that's fine.
Why not?
Mm-hmm. I'm going to start it over because I don't want to miss anything.
Yeah.
Hey, my lady. You know, things have been going so tough and so rough. We need to get away. You know, just the two of us. We should take a little trip. What do you think about that?
She likes the idea.
What do you think about that?
Yeah. Now, was that the bass doing the hmm, or was that
him? No, that
him
was
doing
him.
It? Okay.
Oh, I thought it was a woman's voice.
Well, no, she did. She answered, but after he said, how'd you like, hmm?
He said, hmm.
Yeah, if you want to back it up a couple seconds.
Or was Tim Allen guesting? Guest vocalist?
Yeah.
Early Tim Allen?
All Detroit
Yeah, there you go.
People, yeah.
Yeah.
Tim right. Allen and the Jones Girls.
So wait a minute. There was a woman answered that question. I didn't even catch that.
Oh yeah,
there's a woman in there.
I hear it.
He's going back and forth with her. Here, let me pull this back just a second. Here we go.
We should take a little trip. What do you think about that? Hmm?
She seems satisfied with the idea
already. Yeah. Yeah.
Very nice.
Oh, just the suggestion of going on a. On a little trip.
I'm curious if he shares in the song where the trip is.
He offers some description.
Okay, that's good enough. I want to know where they're going.
you want to know exactly.
Well, I mean, let's take a little trip. We're going to go to Lowe's.
Yeah, I was going to say, she's very trusting that he hasn't picked like some.
No, but women are into that, though.
Well, I know.
I will say.
They're into what?
Going to a home improvement store.
A Saturday, go get some flowers or whatever.
Are they?
Flowers or something for you to do when you get back.
A task for you to accomplish at the home.
Some sort of modification.
Yeah.
I wasn't aware of that.
I'm hoping you injure yourself. Hope you fall off the ladder.
Yeah, right.
Would you like to go away?
See, that makes me nostalgic for my single days, because there were many young ladies who said that to me.
To you. They just approach you at the bookstore.
Maybe it was more like, would you please go away?
Well, they were...
Would you please go away?
Well, would you like to go away? That's polite also.
Yeah, that's true.
Sorry.
I had to disrupt
it there.
Some far off place, a lover's holiday.
Man, that triangle player is earning everybody's paycheck.
Yeah.
He's muting it and
that technique.
He's using both hands on that triangle.
He's probably the type of guy, and as well he should, based on his performances, who takes offense when people suggest that playing the triangle is something that anybody can do.
Yeah.
You just sit there and bang on it. There's some nuance to it.
Let me just say.
It's like a conga player working the drum head, pulling different tones versus just beating on it like a fucking toddler something.
Let's see your average guy do this for 5 minutes and 20 seconds, because that's what we're going to hear.
No. Yeah. Well, as soon as the plane touches down, Lou is going to use both hands on that triangle, too.
Yeah. This is true. And there will be nuance to it. He won't be just banging on it like a toddler, either. But no, as we've talked about, you're not appearing on this album as a musician unless you're at the absolute top of your craft. And that includes the fucking triangle player.
Yeah.
That's how far this extends, the level of musicianship required to really play on any album in the 70s.
Yeah.
Is there any album that came out in the 70s that featured hacks? Maybe some of the... like very primitive punk rock stuff and some of the stuff that was coming out of, Soho area of New York City or whatever. But in terms of like this stuff, big label, R&B, rock, disco, go down the list.
Yeah, if there's money behind it.
Nobody was playing around.
And especially in cases where you've just got one guy, that's all anybody's going to buy the album for, is Lou Rawls or
Engelbert
Humperdinck, whatever.
Yeah.
you don't really, nobody cares who's playing on it. So you get the best.
So you get the best because you're not gonna. You get the people
who are tried and true. You don't take a chance on a musician.
Well, but
in this one,
the, you know who cared about who played on it? The people making the
people
record.
Making it, okay. But the people buying it, they, you don't have to worry about that.
Well, that's what I mean.
Yeah, it wasn't like is that CC DeVille? If it's not, I'm not buying it.
Right.
I'm not picking on CC DeVille. I'm just saying you weren't. It wasn't like a personality. The band, where each guy. It's just these are a bunch of killers, and they're gonna put out great stuff.
Yeah, I mean it's a Wrecking Crew caliber
and important
ensemble.
They're not gonna waste my money because I'm funding this. They're not gonna.
They're
gonna be in there screwing up.
They're gonna be in and out.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. They're gonna nail this.
So I don't know who it is, but it's either someone named David Cruz because he's listed as credited as percussion. Or Larry Washington. So David Cruz or Larry Washington.
I'm going to lean toward the Latino being more of a nuanced percussionist.
That's
yeah, that's fair.
I'm just going to go by my worldly experience and say David Cruz is the triangle player here.
That's fair. Yeah, we'll just
nothing against Larry Washington, but
I'm sure he's staying busy.
Yeah,
on this track.
He's doing something. He's not playing the triangle at that level. No. It's Cruz all the way.
Yeah.
That's it.
That's fair.
On an island made for two. Just me and
there's a hint of Sinatra in that last vocal line.
Yeah, that's true.
Which is about as good as you can get as a vocalist. You know, a lot of people key in on the caricature of the Sinatra persona, his acting, the Rat Pack stuff. Ask anybody who knows anything about vocals, which I don't. I know a little bit about it, but just based on what I've read and heard and like opinions of people who actually know what they're talking about, Sinatra was almost unassailable as a vocalist, like always on tune, incredible performance. It's easy to get to not remember that when you get swept up in the persona and all the, the Phil Hartman imitations and all the other stuff he was involved in. But just as a straight up singer, there have been none better in the history of music.
I've always heard the same thing, too. No one has anything.
Did you catch that? The hint of Sinatra?
Yeah,
when he delivered that line, I instantly was like, fuck, that sounds like Frank.
And one of the, I don't know if it's Lou Rawls' last album that during his lifetime that he made, but it's one of them for sure. I think it was called like Perfectly Frank, something like that. It was like a tribute album, basically.
Wow.
Doing Sinatra songs, so that would make sense.
That's cool. I didn't know he did that.
Yeah, I didn't know he did that either.
Have you heard it?
I probably
checked
have.
It out.
Yeah,
but
I don't really recall it.
Yeah.
In solitude.
The strings come in beautiful.
Yeah, and again, that's that kind of Barry White, Isaac Hayes style orchestration that was prevalent throughout the 70s. And again, to make that happen in the studio and get everybody on the same page, you gotta have just everyone is a top shelf pro and just delivering.
You know what I'd like to be able to do? You know how I'm sure it happens to everybody. They hear a foreign language or something, and I'd like, you know what? It's like I'm never gonna, but I'd really like to be able to speak that language fluently, or whatever, any kind of skill.
Yeah,
like to just think you can learn. To be one of these guys, especially like in the 70s where you've got so much orchestration, who comes in and writes up all the charts.
Yeah,
that would be just unbelievable stuff. Yeah. To be able to do that.
To just for your mind to be able to do that?
Yeah,
for
your mind to do it and to be like one of the people where the song is written, but they're like, all right, we got strings. We don't have anything written for him.
Nick, figure it out.
Here you go. Here's some paper.
Yeah, here's some
paper. Here's some paper. There's an old piano in the corner.
Yeah.
Go figure it out.
They'll be here tomorrow.
That, any sort of musical performance or composition, anything, that to me is like light years away. No idea how those guys did that.
Yeah, I mean,
can't even conceive it.
In high school, I dabbled in that. I was the guitar player in the jazz band in high school, and I had to read a chord chart.
Mm-hmm.
And that was fucking hard. And again, you know, we would rehearse the material before we go out and perform it. These guys are coming in, you're just putting the music in front of them, and they're laying down a take inside of a half an hour, probably, from first seeing it.
Yeah. Unbelievable.
And I dabbled into reading like music notation and stuff, but to like just be so adept at that where you just sit down with a chart or a song that you've never heard before because this has been written by somebody.
Yeah, it doesn't exist. Yeah, outside
it doesn't
of that
exist.
Room.
It's not a standard.
Yeah.
To just look at a piece of music and play it, all the tempos right and everything is just that takes that's way. I mean, I was dipped my toe in that pool and it was fucking hard.
Yeah, that's
and I didn't even get 1% as far as what these guys could do.
Mm-hmm.
We can while away the time, free our minds of everything.
Just concentrate on love.
That's a nice thing.
And you know, where are you going to get breakfast the next day at the resort you're at or whatever? You know, which restaurant you're going to get?
Yeah.
And then I mean, you got the Jim Henson honeymoon picture to reflect on.
Yep.
That's a picture of two people who are just concentrating on love.
That's true.
Is it though? I mean, there's a lot of other stuff to be concentrating on in that picture. The food. It's a lot of food.
Something tells me they made it though.
Well, it does just seem like it's
they whipped
like a basement. You know, I don't know. They're in this brick. I can't really tell what it is.
They are brick walling, aren't
they? Brick walling, yeah.
It could possibly be a white collar prison, and that's a conjugal visit.
Could be.
This guy's an Epstein type character.
I mean, he must own the prison, aside from being a prisoner.
Yeah,
exactly. One of those. He just slips a bribe to the guards, and he's able to stage this sort of thing behind bars.
Yeah, bring the olives and corn.
Gets croissants made to resemble his own uncircumcised hog. Just lay it out there on the tray.
180 degree curve on that thing.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Amazing. Goes back to where it started from.
Oh man. Yeah.
But yeah, no. So far, so good. You know, it's and as we're getting to the end of February and coming into March, the traditional spring break month. You know.
Yeah,
lovers' holidays should already have been scheduled or should be set in motion like immediately. You can swing it.
That's the time, huh?
It is the time, I think.
Yeah.
After the winter's over, you're looking to, you know, the cabin fever, the clocks have been turned forward again, days are getting longer. You know, it's time to have a lover's holiday.
Mm. You got one scheduled?
We do every year for the...
But you've already done it for this year? You got it lined up?
No, it's all set.
Yeah, okay. Very good.
Think how peaceful it would be. Miles out of town. With no one else around.
That's nice.
See, now that is nice. Maybe not completely off the grid, but it's, you know, you still maybe crave an internet connection, but but since we were talking about the pandemic earlier, now it's hard to believe it's been
4 years
already. Yeah. But prior to the pandemic, every spring break we would you know, hit up an all-inclusive somewhere in the Caribbean, you know, but then when the pandemic hit and fucked up all the air travel, and you know, you basically couldn't do anything. We just started looking into getting these Airbnb cabins that are somewhat in the middle of nowhere.
Right.
And that's what we're doing again this year, and I've totally enjoyed that, just getting away from everything and, you know, close enough to civilization where you can get provisions and, you know, hit up a restaurant or two. But other than that, just getting away from people, it's a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
To disturb our reverie, a quiet sea.
Exactly. You don't want any other assholes disturbing your revelry. Is that what he said? Revelry?
Reverie. Right?
I don't know.
Revering each other as lovers.
I told you I had the lyrics up. They're not the right lyrics.
Oh, no.
It's on the song that I'm playing on Apple Music. Click lyrics. Not the right song.
Right song?
No, the lyrics don't match the song.
I think it's Reverie. It's okay. Makes perfect sense, actually, that it would be. A state of dreamy meditation or fanciful music.
Yeah, that's it, then.
Lost in reverie. Yes, a daydream. Reverie. A fantastic.
It's a nice lyric.
That's it.
A fantastic.
Yeah, that's the word then. But yeah, you don't want some other prick ruining that, you know. Going to a resort and a bunch of fucking bratty kids running around with their water wings ruining everything. Give me the adult side, adults only, and just keep away from me. The last all-inclusive we went to down in, like, I think it was Cancun area, was perfect. It was adults only, and it wasn't jam-packed. It wasn't a bunch of crazy partiers. I would go back there in a second. And I think we'll probably do that again eventually. But right now, we're just like enjoying getting in the car and going like 4 or 5 hours. And winding up somewhere and just hanging out.
That sounds pretty appealing. Just, yeah, there's so many places that you could just do a road trip to.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Do you know the group Change? Anyone?
I don't think so.
Do not know.
Well, whatever. They've got a song called A Lover's Holiday. First songwriters, Kenny Babyface Edmonds. Then Jermaine Jackson.
My goodness.
Daryl Simmons, Antonio Reed. So that's the lyric. I don't know how that gets mixed up, but those are the lyrics that are on the screen that are attached to this song.
Well, you rarely have to look up a Lou Rawls.
Yeah.
He's from the old school where
he enunciates.
Yeah. He's not shouting anything. He's not making it difficult to understand.
No. He wants you to know what he's saying.
Mm-hmm.
A quiet sea, just you and me.
He likes that.
I love that. This is the second time we've gotten to that
thing,
to that part of the song. Mm-hmm. I love that it just kind of hangs there.
Yeah,
for a couple of bars, like there's a suspense to it.
Mm-hmm.
He's painting quite a picture with the silvery moon.
Yeah, he is.
That's something that never goes away. That theme in popular music.
Using
the moonlight for romance, which we've had here on a couple of songs
several times. Yeah,
yeah, you can't go wrong with that. It's a winning formula.
I mean, it's one of the oldest devices, but it never fails.
Well, the moon's been around for a long time. So
oldest ride, longest line. That's what they say about the moon.
Exactly. Cavemen were fornicating to the silky, silvery moon and enjoying it.
Yeah.
brontosauruses were reproducing under the light of the silvery moon.
Most likely.
Yeah. You mean most likely?
Most likely they needed it.
Oh, yeah. But I mean, what do you think they only they reproduced during the day?
They made sure that you couldn't see the moon anywhere.
That was the day
they
chose.
All right, it's clear.
All right, it's mating season.
No, a brontosaurus could probably have sex after a sizable meal. I would
no
think
big
that
deal
that's
to
probably
them.
Not even a consideration there.
Yeah, they don't care.
Probably need to.
It's a young man's game and a dinosaur's game to do that.
Not a raptor or something like that. We're talking.
It's got to be a sizable dinosaur.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One with no wings. Just plods along. Yeah. You know, just. Mm-hmm. Nothing's holding him back from a sex session, and you would think that they're just probably constantly either eating or having sex, and
well, in either case, many smaller animals die during the process.
Yes,
I'm sure,
absolutely,
getting stomped on.
There's collateral damage in their
poor animals.
Yeah, and their lovers' holidays.
Yeah, it's
back in those days.
It's practically a Michael Bay film during that.
Yeah, the equivalent of a brontosaurus clearing off a desk with a lover.
Yes, exactly.
Clearing a forest with their tail.
Species went extinct.
Yeah.
Every time.
Yeah. All right, let's keep going.
Sizable meal of brontosaurus burgers were probably enjoyed. Another inside joke that we won't explain, but had to drop that one on Andy.
Thank you.
Classic, one of his all-time classic lines from back in the day. Should we say what it is?
You
we
could, should. Yeah, that's fine.
You might have to help me with this. I might get it wrong, but it's when... You were working at the cafe, right?
Yes, yeah.
And there was a table of old ladies
that
you were waiting on, and what you said, you told them we were out of brontosaurus burgers or what,
something like that. Like, go? I came back to
like
the...
Like, you did actually do it.
Yeah, but I came back to the area, the prep area, with the little ticket of what they wanted to order. Said something like that.
Decided to take a shot at their
experience. I think I was irritated
their
about
level
something.
Level of experience on this planet.
But I think that's what made it funny, because I was genuinely irritated, and then Chris started laughing, and then I felt better. I was like, okay, I'm not mad anymore. I didn't even mean for it to. It was more of an anger thing than a humor thing when I said it, and then it was fun. It was alleviated my anger quickly.
Brontosaurus burgers, the table of old ladies, classic. Jones Sisters carrying the day, that little musical interlude.
Mm-hmm.
Got some, you know, musicians flexing a little bit, and the Jones Sisters taking over vocally. Lou has stepped aside at this point.
And the groove is king at this point.
Yeah, well, yes it is.
And we haven't mentioned the bass, but it seems every February... We
always
talk about how just these every bass player is incredible on every song that we listen to.
Yeah,
and pretty much.
Around,
same case here.
Mm-hmm. It's very true. I forgot what I was going to say now. Damn it. One of you said something about it. Oh, I was going to say maybe this is the part of the song where Lou went to go get a bucket of ice or something.
Could be.
He stepped away for a moment.
He went to get more sour cream for the bowl of borscht.
This amount of sour cream is not going to do.
No.
Like a double sour cream.
He was kind of, you know, you're at a party. You just kind of, you're chip and dip kind of hors d'oeuvre kind of thing. He didn't realize that the sour cream was quickly disappearing. And
yeah.
He needed that.
Mm-hmm. On a lover's holiday. On a lover's holiday.
Did you hear there was some sort of like weird whistling synthesizery sound just maybe like 5 seconds like or so back, like when he's talking about whiling away?
I didn't notice
there's
that.
There's some kind of like a weird like like a whistle thing going on.
Let's go back and hear it.
The time, free our minds of everything.
Yeah, I heard that.
Don't know. Someone threw that in there just for fun, probably.
Yeah.
He's whistling for the room attendant. Yeah, we need more sour cream over here. Hey, you.
Yeah.
Sour cream.
It's
room 302. Come on.
Well, that's just like if you're at a restaurant and you put your glass off to the edge of the table. It's empty. That's a clear sign.
Mm-hmm.
We need more. You move your bowl of borscht a little bit off to the side, and they see there's no sour cream on it.
Yeah,
well,
they should know.
You would expect that level of service at a 5-star resort, which is...
Or a 5-star prison, as Andy was accusing... this picture.
No, I was accusing.
Yeah, I said a basement.
Chris
turned into a
white collar
prison.
Oh, that's right.
A conjugal visit for this guy.
Yeah,
he looks like an El Chapo type character.
He could have been running drugs.
Because I'm thinking like Jim Henson and the lady from ABBA, kind of. That's
probably happened. This could be it.
Could be it. Jim Henson maybe. Took some liberties with his taxes, got locked up for a little
bit. If this guy didn't have as much chest hair as he did, the whole picture wouldn't work, I don't think.
No, it would not.
No.
It would be ruined.
Yeah, you have to have that.
Yeah, horny guy. Hairy man.
And then just concentrate forward.
The bass going a little going off in the background.
This
I heard some kind of like chord slide and like a pluck at the end, high register pluck.
It's that time of the song where he gets to cut loose a little bit.
Yeah. Lou is too.
Sensing a fade out coming up here soon, so he's going to take some chances.
How much time do we have?
About a minute and a half.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, well.
Yeah, because I know Lou's got some things to say here, so.
He's got something on his mind.
Generally, you hear them go off script as they're approaching a fade out, but, you know.
Yeah.
You know what I just noticed in this picture? Are there, like, two long, thin sausages right to the right of the corn?
Yes, there are.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because I was like, what are those? Like churros or giant cinnamon?
No, they're like a 2-foot long, two sausages, like two Polish sausages.
The world's largest cinnamon stick that this guy got a hold of.
That would be more ideal, I think, in this situation.
Yeah.
Who wants to be lying down on a bearskin rug, nude, eating a Polish sausage?
Well,
there's no utensils there.
The lady particularly looks rather glossy.
Yeah.
So that could be sausage grease.
She might have Polish sausage grease on her. She doesn't care.
And the meat sweats. Glistening from the meat sweats.
There's some other sort of like sausage, real big, thick, stubby sausage to the right of that.
To the right of that. I couldn't tell if that was a sausage or if that was another piece of bread, like a pretzel roll or something.
Who knows?
Yeah. I don't know.
They ate it all.
It's quite a setup.
They ate it all.
I ate it all. I ate it all, pal.
I ate it all. That's right. I ate it all, pal.
Yeah, there was not a scrap left after this.
Mm. Well, let's see what happens next.
What it's all about. We could just slip away somewhere. So nice if you could just get away somewhere where there's no phone, no television, you know what I mean? Yeah. No people hanging around.
he's kind of talking his way out of a sale at this point. He's going over all the selling points like for the fifth time.
Well, he's really stressing.
I think she's in. He's stopped talking now. Yes. Now, no offense to Lou. I mean, he's pretty much unassailable. But yeah, I don't think he got a seller on the concept anymore. I think she's in.
He's sick and tired of these people who are hanging around. He's mentioned it several times in the song.
Well, you know,
I don't know who these people are.
Well, we all have them in our lives, whether it be coworkers, neighbors, jackasses you encounter just randomly going about your business. It's like, I want to get away from all of these people.
He's really stressing it, though. Wherever we go,
there won't be anybody there.
Nobody.
No phone, no TV.
I can't
stand. Not going to be watching Judge Judy.
No.
Nothing like that.
In fact, you go back to week one and simply disconnect the phone.
Yeah.
Don't have it connected. Rip it out of the wall.
Yeah.
Back in the 70s, that's what you'd have to do. It's a landline-only situation.
Mm-hmm.
Nowadays, of course, you know, maybe a remote location where you don't get cell service, but if you do, shut your phone off. It's not easy to do these days, but...
Yeah, if this song were contemporary, he'd have to say something about, I'm not taking any Teams calls.
Yeah, while I'm on
setting my out of office and I'm sticking to it.
Yeah.
No work emergencies, none of that bullshit.
Yeah. Oh, man. Lucky guy. Lucky lady.
Some place where you can just say, hey, maybe that's cool. If we want to go eat, we can. If we don't, we don't have to.
The best part. You want to go eat? Yeah. That's fine.
We can.
Yeah, if you got to go to the bathroom, go ahead. If you don't, that's fine,
then
too.
Don't go, then.
Yeah, I got to say, he's, you know, you can talk your way out of a sale. At some point, you just keep your mouth shut and go about your business.
Well, with this picture of this couple, I don't know. This is not, you can eat if you want to. This is, we're eating all of this.
Yeah. I mean, you don't order that kind of spread and just not touch it. I mean, that just doesn't happen.
You don't have a wok full of cauliflower and whatever kind of greens.
Yeah.
And just leave it.
I mean, the amount of bribery within the walls of the prison that was required to have this delivered, you're going to partake in it. There's not. Yeah. I'm not hungry. Yeah. Yes, you are. Yeah,
and you're eating.
This is a hijacked truck full of Marlboros, basically, to be able to arrange this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's so nice. That's a lover's holiday. And as I said before, it doesn't take long. Day, 2 days, just that solitude of being.
As I said before, yeah, I know, you said it like 5 times already. Enough.
As I said before.
Yeah. It doesn't have to be long. 1 day, 2 day, 3 day. Sounded like Fred Bear at this point, you know.
This is like when I would write a...
Brown Bear. Grizzly Bear.
So this was like writing a book report in high school. Yeah, again,
yeah,
just,
exactly.
To sum it up.
To reiterate, in conclusion, looping back around, we can, you know, doesn't have to be a long day or two, you know.
Proving my initial hypothesis. Yeah.
Just in case you forgot, it can be 2 days, it can be 1 day, it can be a day and a half.
Yeah, need I remind you.
It can be 2.5 days, 2.25 days, yeah. Whatever you want to do, I don't care.
It's up to
you.
Yeah,
he's already laying it on thick here.
He's desperate to get out of whatever environment he's
like,
currently.
Okay, let's get the fuck out of here. This is sounding so good, let's make it happen.
Mm-hmm.
And as I said before, it doesn't take long. A day, 2 days. Just that solitude of being together alone. Just concentrating on one another. On a lover's holiday.
This is when the woman busts out that line from Eastbound and Down when he had the Mexican woman.
Oh, yeah.
He was rattling off all this nonsense, and she finally just goes, stop talking and pull out your dick. I want to play. That's when he would start, after he goes, as I said before, it could be a day or two, just stop talking and pull your dick out. That's when you get the intervention from the woman. Stop mansplaining.
Yeah.
And let's get down to business.
You've made the sale, like you said.
On a lover's holiday.
We got like a little keyboard
solo
going on there. That's nice. Again, it's happened many times on this podcast. Mm-hmm. We wish we could hear it go on a little bit longer. But,
hear what's next, right?
But they faded out.
Yeah, they took it away from us.
They just they let it get a little buck wild at the end and leave it to our imaginations.
Yeah, maybe that's for the best sometimes.
Yeah,
I don't know.
It's probably a strategy. Mm-hmm. Probably on purpose.
All right, Nick.
What?
You brought it to the show. What are you going to do? It's time to vote. Sweet surrender or kick in the crotch?
I'm going to give it a sweet surrender, of course.
It's sweet surrender. Hell yes.
It's just like pretty much everything in his catalog. We're very well produced. He did standards, but he had all these other songs that for whatever reason, it's like, how come when you first kind of start getting into the catalog, it's like, how come people haven't covered this since then? You know, there's so many of them where it's like, this is just like a great song that nowadays is forgotten.
Mm-hmm. It's true.
There's just so many.
Yeah.
Love it.
Well, I think, now? Yeah, I'll do Sweet Surrender.
It's sweet surrender. Hell yes.
I mean, as we were kind of jokingly alluding to, but I think in the modern times we need a song like this more than ever. Just people have too much bullshit going on in their lives. We can all relate to that, obviously. As can anybody living in the modern world, just got way too much horse shit going on in their lives.
Yeah.
Get rid of it for a day or two, you know, ideally longer, but if it's only a day or two, that's better than nothing.
It's true.
And cut the noise out of your life and steal away for something like this. This is the, you know, the recipe everybody needs. And just so we know, I know I probably committed a blasphemy by sort of ripping on Lou Rawls a little bit there for all of his talking at the end. I just thought it was kind of funny where he's just like, you know. And to reiterate, it can only be for a day or two and stuff like that. It's like, okay.
Yeah, but who doesn't do that when
you're excited?
Something sounds really
good. That's a
good
point, yes.
I do that. I know. I keep repeating
myself. Yeah, and something like this is certainly something to be excited about, especially in the modern world. I think, you know, people need to do this more for themselves and the significant other in their lives and... And you know, just say no to all the static and the noise out there. Yeah. It's just Jesus. It's unrelenting. Mm-hmm. So this is a much needed message in today's society.
All right, I am also going to give it a sweet surrender.
It's sweet surrender. Hell yes.
Great choice. Perfect song for this month. I was going to say earlier when we were listening to it, I think when the first chorus came in, it kind of made me think like this almost could have been commissioned by Holiday Inn or something at the time and been in commercials.
Not something that would have been out of bounds for
not at all.
Mr. Rawls there. Nope. I mean, all the Budweiser stuff made it onto the live album like what, the year before this?
Probably.
I think that was
70 something,
78,
right?
I think was that double live album. Yeah.
Yeah.
And,
Budweiser commercials during the show.
Not that it's his finest moment, but you could find it on YouTube, the WGN Chicago Channel 9 song that he did.
He did one
in the early 80s. Yeah, there's a commercial out there.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
I mean, he's great. It's kind of cheesy, of course.
Yeah.
Because it has
local
to be.
Local TV.
Yeah.
Interesting.
He got paid.
He did.
All right. That's all that matters.
Well, let's see. He's got one more thing. We're going to find out if this song really matters.
All right, Hammond! I got a question for you.
Paul Stanley needs to know if Lover's Holiday is the direction he should have gone.
Lou Rawls is Greek.
Yeah.
Which, that's an instant.
Yes, from yesterday.
Yeah. 2 days ago. Looked just like him.
Did. Looked just like Paul Stanley. What's that person's name?
The aunt. I don't know, but it's the aunt from My Big Fat Greek Wedding.
Yeah, Nick sent
someone,
a picture.
Someone sent me a picture of her for a different reason. And I was like, wow. I honestly, you know, there's that split second when you first see something before it registers.
Yeah.
I thought, is that Paul Stanley?
Hey.
Like, yeah. Same hair, same face, pretty much.
Yeah, same eyebrows, same everything.
It's funny to see, like, the, you know, the rock stars kind of when they age.
Yeah.
What, you know, just because you see an average person, you see average people all the time who have aged, but
right.
Someone trying to keep it up a certain way. It's interesting right now to see. Anyway.
Yeah.
But what does Paul Stanley want to
know? He wants to know if this is the direction he should be going in with his 1978 solo album.
Yeah, it is.
Did he make a mistake? I guess it's 79, sorry.
Yeah,
I think it's 78.
Should Dynasty have a song like
this? Should Dynasty have a song like this? Well, are your votes in?
Yeah,
mine's in.
Yes. Same order of voting that we just did?
Yeah, that works for me. You okay with that?
Yeah.
Okay.
It has to be unanimous.
Are we doing the LNB voting or not? Probably not.
No,
the world isn't ready for that. No. So we'll do the typical rock roll boner or possible no boner,
yeah,
if anybody's inclined that way. We know how we know the drill, so votes are in, let's do it.
Rock
roll
big ass boner.
Oh yeah. My goodness.
How could you not? You'd be a fool not to.
Yeah, just the theme of it, and just, you know, as we talk about the musicianship, the vocals, Lou Rawls, it's all top shelf. But when you throw in the theme of it and how it applies to, you know, back then, but also now.
Now even more so.
Yeah, irresistible.
Just like everything now, amplified.
Mm-hmm.
The need for this is also amplified.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it is. All right, well, oh, look at that. Nick's got his Lou Rawls.
There's Lou.
Upper deck.
He's got a signed Lou.
He does.
Signed Lou.
Congratulations on that signed Lou,
oh,
Nick.
Thanks.
It's big.
Lowballed him. Got away with it.
Yeah. Autographs on eBay, I'll tell you.
You lordballed him,
actually. All right, well, if you disagree with us, we are sorry.
That's just the fucking way it is.
Yes. Deal with it. Let's take a quick break. What do you think, Nick? Commercial break?
Can't wait.
Favorite part of the show is coming up. Stay tuned.
Don't get yards of questions, motherfucker. I give them.
Swing away.
Yes.
Yes.
Chief.
Yeah. Welcome to another Yardo Questions, brought to you by Budweiser
and your local travel agent.
That's right. Yes, I got one in front of me here. This week's Yardo Questions comes to us from Wes Nations. What's going on,
yes.
Wes?
How you doing, Wes?
Thank you, sir.
My guy.
Says, love you guys. Thanks for everything. Nib High Football Rules. All right. That's from Billy Madison, Chris. You haven't seen it yet, have you?
Haven't seen it, no.
The second Adam Sandler reference in today's episode.
What was the first one?
That I Ate It All, Pal.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
Kind of an indirect Adam Sandler reference.
Yeah. I Ate It All, Pal. All right, question one. As kids, we had celebrity heroes that we thought were unreachable. Icons such as Eddie Van Halen or Clint Eastwood. As adults, we kind of grow out of that and realize they are only human. But which celebrity, living or dead, would you be most nervous to be around due to being such a big fan of their artistry?
Wow.
Living or dead is what brought Nick in. When it was living, Nick was disinterested in the question. Dead, ooh, yeah.
Well, and I mean, I guess it had the whole stress there. Is you don't want to be an idiot to one of your heroes.
It's hard, man.
You don't want to go away thinking like, wow, they thought I was a complete moron.
It's weird when you meet someone, even if it's not like a hero, but when you meet someone and you know it's going to be just a few seconds, but you want to say something not typical, but not weird.
It's almost like going to a funeral.
You just had to drop something quickly.
You want to make sure
say the right thing.
It goes well. Yeah.
Yeah. It's going to be one shot. And either way, it's not going to go great, no matter what. Is this going to be okay?
Yeah.
Or is this going to be bad?
And I guess you're also worried about even holding their attention.
Right. Yeah, like you meet Eric Singer. He's got his Asian buddy.
He's waving his hands to him.
Yeah. Completely disinterested in anything you're saying to him.
He won't draw mustaches on the rest of the guy's pictures in the Sonic Boom album cover.
No, he will not do that.
I think that would have been fun. Anyway.
It's disrespectful.
It would have sat in my closet. I'm not putting it on eBay.
Read the question again.
He said when you're a young man, there are... I'll read the whole thing. As kids, we had celebrity heroes we thought were unreachable. Eddie Van Halen, Clint Eastwood. As adults, we kind of grow out of it, realize they're just human. But which celebrity, living or dead, would you be most nervous to be around due to being such a big fan of their artistry?
Now, can we? Can it be someone, an experience we actually had?
Sure.
Because in my case, it was Eddie Van Halen when I worked at the Hard Rock. I could not fucking believe I was standing in the same room. Like, from me to Nick, was there he is, you know?
Yeah.
And I literally could feel myself, tears were welling up in my eyes. And that was my challenge. It's like, I'm not going to bust out crying in front of this guy, but I could feel the tears welling up that I just couldn't believe I was standing right next to him.
Yeah.
And so I actually lived it and, had to consciously keep my composure. But had I, not been, cognizant of it, I would have just started bawling right in front of the guy.
It's a big one.
But yeah, I mean I can't think of anything that would approach that. Certainly at this stage of life, I mean it's like I'm trying to think if somebody would have a similar effect on me now, and I can't really think of anybody.
Yeah.
But I actually lived that with a person that he mentioned, and yeah, it's crazy. So.
Nick.
Man. Well, I'll go, if I may, I'll go with a living person and a deceased person.
It's your show, Nick. Do whatever you want.
Living person, because I'm such a fan and I have so much respect for what he's done musically.
Mm-hmm.
He seems like the nicest guy, but I wouldn't want to be an idiot. You know what I mean? Like, I wouldn't want to say something stupid. And that'd be Robert DeLeo. Seems like a sweetheart of a guy. All you ever hear is he's a sweetheart of a guy.
Yeah.
I don't want to be the one guy who says something dumb.
What's your problem, dude?
Yeah. Just seems like just the nicest guy. And for whatever reason, I don't know if I would be completely at ease, at least right away.
Yeah.
Maybe it would take a little while. But, yeah, he would be that. And then,
I'd have to go with, I'm just going to stick with the month. I got to go with Lou Rawls.
Okay.
Just someone who is so cool.
Yeah.
Everything he says is like, I mean, even though in this song we were talking about him rambling a bit.
Yeah.
He had some time to fill.
Yeah.
But he just seemed like he was going to say something cool. I'm not going to be able to match it.
Yeah.
I don't want to be like trying to, and you don't want to be one of those people who try to one-up someone like that.
Oh, yeah,
because you're not going to.
It's not
going to
work.
No.
You're going to make a fool of yourself.
Yeah. So, I'll go with those.
Those are good ones.
I did get Robert DeLeo to answer a question.
On Instagram or something?
On Instagram.
I remember you mentioned
that. Yeah, I made a comment. He told me he complimented my comment, which I'd be like, okay.
That was good enough for you.
I can die in peace.
Yeah. That's a good interaction versus the interaction we saw this week between some guy and Shannon Sharp lobbing insults at the guy. So that's a different kind of interaction. But yes. When you can actually interact with somebody like that, it's easier than now than ever. And when you can get that kind of acknowledgement, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's all I need. Too nervous to actually try to meet someone.
Yeah. Question two. Nothing beats kick-ass jams on a killer car stereo. It has been written that Dimebag Darrell would take demos to his car for a cruise. Apparently, it was his test for quality.
That's a common thing, but yes.
Name one band/artist that you would have loved to drive around with listening to their new album, and which album would that have been? Oh, and Wes says, mine would have been cruising with Eddie Van Halen in 78 listening to the debut.
Wow. Okay, yeah. So we're talking about something that was before our time then.
Sure.
Because
well,
there are many.
It doesn't have to be.
Okay, because there was seeming to be the stipulation of would have been instead of you have a go-to, because there are plenty of those.
It doesn't have to be.
Don't know why. Maybe because of the Andy intro clip today. But I think it came out the year I was born. The Heaven and Hell album. Busting that out. Like, first listen, driving around with Neon Nights kicking in.
Mm.
With Dio sitting shotgun? with who of the band?
Ooh, man. Iommi.
Yeah?
Yeah.
That's your choice.
I'm going to go Iommi.
Wow.
Okay. Well, yeah.
It's between him and Geezer, I'm thinking. I don't know that I would want Dio there. That's another case where he seemed like he was very sharp and very kind of one of those people where you can't just make a comment and he'll think about what you just said and want you to elaborate. And you might have just made an off comment. He would put you on the spot, I think. Iommi would be like, he'd be a little more chill, probably. Yeah.
You know, he'd have the look on his face from the No Stranger to Love video, being stuck in a car with Nick. Just have that tired, destroyed look on his face. Like, are we going to run out of gas soon, or what's going on here? That's an interesting choice. Yeah, are you a fan of that album?
Yes.
Okay.
I am very much.
I don't think we've talked about much about the Dio era of Sabbath and whether you liked it or not.
We had Stars, which I don't think counts. We haven't had a proper Dio song ever.
Well, we had the Andy entrance music.
That's as close as we've gotten, yeah.
Yeah, I was thinking about that too. We haven't had that yet, so something to maybe look forward to in March. Make that Dio, when we get back to the normal
in
form.
In Dio-cember later this year.
Yeah,
that would work.
Dio-cember. Oh, boy. Okay. My answer, I talk about these guys a lot, but... So I realized today that I just saw on their social media feed they posted a flashback video to 10 years ago when they were on this, I think, I say French TV show or something, but they weren't, the hosts weren't even speaking English, but they were, you know, in studio guest, and seemed to be playing it live, but it was Rival Sons doing Electric Man, and I would have loved to have Jay Buchanan in my car listening to that, the Great Western Valkyrie album. It's one of my all-time favorite albums, and he's another guy I met backstage at the Crowfoot in Pontiac. I went to Pontiac, Michigan, and went to see them right around 10 years ago now, and went with the old singer of the Mean Reds, and he had a friend of his who knew people at the Crowfoot, and he got us backstage, and I met those guys, totally cool, you know. And he actually said to me, Jay Buchanan, that if you're familiar at all with Rival Sons music, you know he's one of the greatest vocalists on the planet right now. He actually said to me, he goes, you know, I fancy myself more as a songwriter than a singer. And I wanted to slap him for saying that. I'm like, dude, I just watched you shred your vocal cords for 2 hours, delivering one of the greatest vocal performances I've ever seen, and you consider that second to your songwriting?
Yeah.
Not that he's a great songwriter, but when he said that, I was just like, what are you talking about, man? I don't get that at all. I didn't challenge him, obviously. But,
yeah. You know.
People never want to just conquer one mountain, I guess, right?
No.
Yeah, but I mean, it was mind-blowing to hear that after watching him in action for 2 hours, because I mean, and he doesn't seem to be slowing down at all. It's like you listen to that guy and you're like, when is his just voice box gonna explode? And they've been at it for like 15 years now.
Wow.
He's still going strong, so that would be my answer.
Right. Question 3. Lead, rhythm, and songwriting. You have to pick 3 guitarists that you wish... that you wish could possess their individual skill in each category.
You wish that you could?
I think that's what it's supposed to be, that you wish you could.
Songwriting, rhythm, and lead.
Yes, and Wes gives 3 choices for himself. He says, lead, Audley Freed. Rhythm, Eddie Van Halen. Songwriting, Jimmy Page. Interesting choices.
Oh, man. I guess I'll get it rolling here. Songwriting. Gotta go John Fogerty.
That's a good one.
Who's better than that?
That's a good one.
Rhythm, I'm gonna go Brad Whitford.
Ooh.
You could go with Brad Whitford as your lead choice too.
That's true. I mean, yeah.
His lead playing is underrated.
That's true.
And a lot of what people think Joe Perry's playing, he's playing.
Yeah. So. And lead. Let's see, because I mean, let me think if there's someone that is not commonly thought of when you think of lead shredder kind of guitar players. Maybe I'm wrong in that statement, because this is someone that you think of, but I'll go with Jakey Lee.
For songwriting?
No, for lead.
Oh, for lead. No, that's a great choice. Jeez.
I was going to try to go for someone a little less common, like that you'd be less likely to think of for that answer, but I'm going to go Jakey Lee.
No, there's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
That guy's just, everything he's done has been quality. He's like the Leo DiCaprio of rock guitar. It's like, can you name something that he's played on that hasn't been great? I can't. And yes, that includes the Red Dragon Cartel stuff.
Oh, absolutely.
Both those albums are excellent. The second one especially, I mean, he really branched out on that and sort of solidified a lineup and just put out some really interesting stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't think of anything he's played on that hasn't been good. I mean, the Badlands stuff is incredible in my opinion. But that's a great one. You didn't go with us to that Red Dragon Cartel show at Reggie's. That was fucking awesome.
I missed out on it.
You had Greg Chase on of Badlands on bass, which he was filling in for the regular bass player, and it happened to be at one of those shows. And to all the sound men out there who are always bitching about how loud the guitar is, and you got to turn it down because it's, you know, it'll mess with the mix or the PA, blah, blah, blah. He had one of those EVH stacks, a full stack, no mic on it. The stage volume sounded fucking perfect. Wow. Granted, it's Jakey Lee and not some dickhead in a bar or a club just playing way too loud, but that was glorious to see. I mean, obviously the drums and the bass and the vocals were pumping through the PA, but he just went straight stage volume.
Wow.
I walked around the club. There was no drop in quality, no matter where you were standing. That stack filled up the room and just went toe-to-toe with the PA. It sounded fucking great. So, there you go. Lead playing would be the guy I talked about when we had Todd Kearns on, about when we played in Davenport, and my lead style was compared to his. That would be Slash. Love his lead playing. Rhythm guitar, you got to go with Malcolm Young. I mean, doesn't get any better than that for rock and roll rhythm playing. To my ears. And then songwriting. That's a tough one. Nick picked that's the top of the heap right there. Doesn't get any better than that. So try and come close to that. So songwriting. Man, that's a tough one. To think whose songs really resonate with me. Damn, that's a tough one. Songwriting. I guess I gotta throw it over to Keith Richards. I mean,
sure,
you know, the stuff him and Mick have come up with over the years. You know, it's been incredible.
Yeah.
But from Beggar's Banquet to 1968 to Undercover, which was 1983, I want to say. 15 straight years, not a bad album in that whole run. I mean, some are better than others, but to my estimation, it's not a bad album, that whole string. 15 straight years of quality, top quality material. So, most, if not all of it, is due just to the songwriting. So I gotta give it up to Keith for that.
Yeah. The guy knows a hook, that's for sure.
Oh, yeah. I mean, him and Mick together, obviously, are just bring out the best in each other. And you know, and then Mick Taylor, I considered naming him as lead playing, as who I'd like to emulate. He'd probably be a close second there, but you know, they just the chemistry and just the creativity of those guys over a long period of time is pretty much unmatched.
All right, well, thank you, Wes, for your Yardo questions. And if you want to send a Yardo questions to us, go to potofthunder.com, click that little widget, send 3 questions our way, make it happen. It's going to be good. But you know what time it is, Nick? It's late. We're recording this at night.
Yeah.
I'm going to get in that bed.
Oh, am I ever.
Yeah.
Well, I guess we have to say goodbye for another year.
Sad, isn't it?
It is. But it has to happen.
Has to happen. That's what makes things special. They come and they go.
It inspires us to keep plugging along and get to next February.
Yeah.
So, but, you know, it's no secret that a lot of our listeners prefer just when we focus on the more rock stuff and the stuff that's on the listener submission list. And be getting back to that next week, and it'll be my pick, and we'll get back at it. So, something to look forward to.
All right, until next time.
To say my line.
It's okay that you didn't. I just wanted to hear one more time before before next year.
Yeah, I blew that. I'm not ready. Yeah, I don't know if I can do that twice.
All right, well then how about this? We'll go out with this. We'll be back next week.